Morning, church.
Morning. Morning.
It's good to. It's awesome to worship together, to hear voices in unison, in harmony, singing God's praises. What a treasure it is. We are in a series for the summer on the fruit of the Spirit, the Spirit's fruit in our lives. We are going to tackle joy this morning. The fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is joy. It's interesting to me that joy is listed second. In this list of nine aspects of the Christian life, love tops the list, and joy comes right after it. Now, I don't want to make too big of a deal about the order here, because as we've seen, every aspect is essential. This is one indivisible fruit produced by the Holy Spirit. All of these characteristics together make up genuine fruit. I think people would agree that the most important character trait of a Christian is love. Jesus said they will know you are Christians because of your love that you have for one another. But if we didn't have Galatians in front of us, if it were up to you to choose, what would you choose next? I think there's some unanimity. Love is number one. What's number two?
Joy.
What would you choose to be number two? Cheating. Do you think of what? So, what is the next attribute or characteristic that you think of when you think of Jesus followers that you know? What do they look like? What do their lives look like? Or if you look in your own heart, do you think of someone who is patient, someone who is kind, someone who is faithful or self-controlled? What do you see most evident in the followers of Jesus around you?
Understanding.
What do you see most in your own heart? Do you see joy? Would others look at you and see and say, I see joy there. I see love there and I see joy. Let's pray and then we'll dig in together. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for being faithful to be at work in us, to grow us in our relationship with you, to grow us up, to develop mature character in us. And Lord, this morning as we look at your joy, the joy, Holy Spirit, that you work in us, we pray that we would have ears to hear, that we would have hearts that are open to you, to what you want to say to us, that we would have hearts that respond to the gospel with joy. That you would work this in us by your Spirit and for your glory. It's in Jesus' holy name we ask it. Amen. Remember, this is not a list of moral virtues like those other lists that we find in ancient Greek literature, where it is agreed upon that a good citizen will be upright and honest and generous and chaste because that's what's best for society. It's true, the Christian who has the fruit of the Spirit growing in her or him will be the best citizen and will do what is best for society. But that's not the point here. The point is not to produce outward conformity to a standard that is agreed upon as what is best for everyone. No, this is fruit. This is a changed heart, changed desires, transformed affections. This is not, look at the areas where you fall short and with self-discipline and sheer force of will, Make a positive contribution to society. Do better. Be better. No. This is fruit. Paul says it comes by faith. It comes by believing. It comes by trusting. It comes by depending on the work of another. It is organically produced by God the Holy Spirit who lives inside of the believer. It comes by looking with faith to Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. It is a change at the very core of your being. It is a change of who you are. It's a change of your identity. You were a selfish person. Now, in Christ, you are a loving person. You were grumpy, irritable, angry, sour, dour, down person. Now, joy. This is something that can't be explained naturally. This is supernatural change. This is Holy Spirit change. This is something you can't change by trying harder. This happens by faith, by trusting God to do it in you by His power. This is what we mean when we talk about being born again. Born again, the new birth. The Holy Spirit of God comes in and begins to change, begins to rearrange things. He creates new things in you. He puts to death old things in you. The new birth is inward transformation that results in a changed way of viewing life. Changed attitudes, changed patterns of thinking, changed responses to circumstances. Now remember, this is fruit. It grows organically, slowly, often imperceptibly, but inevitably. God does this, so it happens. Don't be discouraged when you look at your heart and say, wow, I don't see much there. If the Holy Spirit of God is in you, if you belong to Jesus, He is working this in you. And it takes time. So let's look at this together. What is this joy that we're after? Because we don't want to misunderstand and go after the wrong thing. What does this kind of joy look like? What does it act like? To define biblical joy, which is Spirit-produced, supernatural fruit, I want to look at something Jesus said in the Beatitudes. So turn in your Bibles, if you would, to Luke chapter 6. Typically, when we talk about the Beatitudes of Jesus, if you're familiar with the Gospels, you would go to Matthew 5, where Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek." But did you know that Luke also records Jesus' Beatitudes? Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6, Jesus is declaring blessing on His followers. Actually, blessings and curses. We're going to look at both. There are two ways to live. There is the way of blessing. There is the way of happiness. There is the way of joy. And then there is the way of woe. The way of cursing. The way of pain. The wide road that leads to destruction. Jesus is warning us that there is a counterfeit happiness that is temporary and leads to destruction. We need to hear this because there are so many false teachers selling a false gospel that if you follow Jesus, He will bless you. He will prosper you. He will meet all your needs. You are a child of the King, so you should live like a king. Circumstances will all go well for you. You will be healthy, wealthy, and wise. People will like you. That is a false gospel. It's a counterfeit. We need to be warned. I want to start Luke chapter 6, down in verse 24. We're going to look at the curses first. And then we'll go back to the blessings to see what real joy looks like. We want to be aware of the counterfeit and avoid it. Luke chapter 6, verse 24. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, for so their fathers did to the false prophets. Notice the temporary nature of the counterfeit. There is the now, and then the you shall. Woe to you who are rich now, who are full now, who laugh now, who are spoken well of by all now. As followers of Jesus, there is no promise of these things now. Those who have it all now have all the comfort they will ever have now. If that is what you're after, that is all you will get. They shall not be comforted then, he says. They shall be hungry, they shall mourn and weep. They will be condemned like the false prophets before them. This is a sober warning against the prosperity gospel that is rampant in America and abroad. Follow Jesus and he will make everything better for you. In your outward circumstances, things will go well. Not necessarily. So true joy is not connected with popularity or prosperity or plenty. True joy is not bound up in those things. Let's look back at verse 20 of Luke chapter 6 to see what Jesus says about real joy. And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, and revile you, and spurn your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy. For behold, your reward is great in heaven, for so their fathers did to the prophets." You see why I've gone to this passage when we're talking about joy. Jesus talks about rejoicing and leaping for joy in this passage, but it's in an uncomfortable context. Happy are the poor, happy are the hungry, happy are the sorrowful, happy are the hated. This sounds contradictory. This sounds contrary to normal experience. Remember, this is not natural joy, this is fruit, this is supernatural. Supernatural joy, spirit-produced joy. Notice there is an enduring character to the blessedness in this passage. There is a present circumstance, poverty, hunger, sorrow, persecution. There is a present circumstance, then there is a future hope, the kingdom. Satisfaction, laughter, reward in heaven. But there is a permanent blessedness. He says, you are blessed. They are blessed. There is a future hope. There are present circumstances, but there is a present and enduring blessedness. There is definitively a future aspect of joy, but this also overlaps with the present persecution, the present suffering. In the day that you are excluded and slandered and hated, and in that very day, leap for joy. The future hope bleeds over into the present experience and gives joy even in the midst of adverse circumstances. So What are we saying in this passage? What is Jesus saying in this passage? Does this passage that mean that we should be foolish with our finances and bankrupt ourselves, starve ourselves, become obnoxious so people hate us? And that's the path to blessing? Jesus did not tell everyone with possessions to give away all that they have. But he did tell the rich young man in Mark 10, go and sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me. Because Jesus loved him. And Jesus perceived that this man was treasuring temporal things more than God himself. In Matthew 5, Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are the ones who are aware of their poverty, their own spiritual need, and look to Jesus to rescue them. The rich man came to Jesus asking, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do? Jesus was showing him it wasn't what he could do. He's demonstrating to him, you have a heart problem. You love the wrong things too much. You have a problem with your desires. He needed someone to transform his desires. Hunger? How is hunger a blessing? The Matthew passage says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. The ones who are happy are those who understand their desperate lack of the righteousness that God requires and turn to Him alone to meet their need. That seek a righteousness not their own, but a righteousness that comes through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, who was perfectly righteous for us and gives His righteousness to us as a gift. What about persecution? We are not excluded and slandered and hated because we are obnoxious and rude and socially inappropriate. Matthew 5 says, blessed are the meek. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. We are hated only because of our relationship with Jesus. Notice this joy that Jesus is talking about is a joy that is untouched by circumstances. How often is your joy, my joy, a product of circumstances? Things are going well at work. I have joy. Things are going well in my relationships. Makes me happy. Things are looking good with my finances. I have joy. I got what I was hoping to get. I have a happiness. But when money is tight and things seem out of control and I'm facing frustrations and roadblocks and difficulty and challenges and poor health, I experience fear and anxiety. I become irritable and rude. That's natural. But what we're talking about is supernatural. This joy is unaffected by any circumstance. It actually thrives in adversity. It can coexist with grief and pain and loss. What we are after, the fruit of the Spirit, joy, this is something that is untouched, unaffected by outward circumstances, inward circumstances, pain, frustration, depression. John 15, Jesus tells his disciples to stay connected to him, to abide in him. He says in verse 11, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." My joy, Jesus' joy in you, your joy full, full of his joy. Then he commands them to love. He goes on to warn them that the world will hate you like it hated me. In chapter 16 of John, he informs them that he is leaving. But then he promises the presence of the Holy Spirit. In John 16, verse 20, he says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy." Notice very carefully what he does not say. He does not say, "You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will be removed and it will be replaced by joy." He doesn't say that. He does not say that when you are done being sorrowful and when circumstances change, then you will have this joy I'm talking about. He doesn't say that. What he says is, your sorrow will turn into joy. Then he gives an illustration of what he's talking about. John 16, verse 21, the next verse. "When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world." Childbirth, I've been told, is painful. Never experienced it myself. I can't say from personal experience. I have observed childbirth. Many. All my own. There is sorrow. You might even say anguish, unless she has been medicated enough so that she cannot feel. The word there is affliction, persecution, tribulation. Literally, it means pressure. Pressure. When the hour comes, there is pressure. So much pressure, it is painful. Extremely painful. But then the birth happens. And if all goes well, the room that was just moments ago a place of great agony and great suffering is now suddenly filled with joy. But understand, the pain is not gone. She still hurts. She will continue to experience pain for a long time afterwards. But the pain that is still there is now overwhelmed by something greater, something else, something bigger than the pain. The pain, you see, had a purpose. The pain was worth it. The pain is overcome by the joy. It is not that the sorrow is removed and replaced with joy. The sorrow remains, but it is overwhelmed by joy. Jesus goes on to say, "So also you. You have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice. And no one will take your joy from you." No one will take your joy from you. What kind of a joy do you have? Is it a joy that can be taken from you? Someone is mean to you? You stole my joy. This is not that. This is a joy that is unconquerable. This is a joy that is greater than all the sorrow we could ever face. This is not joy because you get to escape from sorrow. Remember, Jesus is saying this to his apostles. Have you ever read some of the stories of how the apostles were martyred? First few chapters of Fox's Book of Martyrs. It's gruesome. It's horrific. It's excruciating. Jesus knew exactly what his followers would experience. He understood the suffering that they would be called to endure, and yet he promises them that no one can take their joy away. He tells them, your joy will be full because it is not your joy, it's my joy in you. No one will take your joy from you. This is Jesus' joy in us. We see this clearly in Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 2, looking to Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising its shame. This is a joy that can even rejoice in trials and suffering. Not just rejoice in spite of trials and sufferings. This is a joy that can rejoice in trials and sufferings. James 1 says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. So I'm facing a trial. What's my inclination? Lord, deliver me from this trial. I don't want to face it. Get me out. Help. This is where we typically go. James says, count it joy. This trial is joy. We see this also in 1 Peter, many other places in the New Testament and Old. Romans 5 says, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. See, there's an understanding that the trials, the sufferings, have a purpose, have a goal. They're taking us somewhere. They're going somewhere. C.H. Spurgeon commented in his morning devotional, commented about trials. He says this, trials make more room for consolation. Great hearts can only be made by great troubles. The spade of trouble digs the reservoir of comfort deeper and makes more room for consolation. Hear what he says there? Trials make more room for consolation. Great hearts can only be made by great troubles. The spade of trouble digs the reservoir of comfort deeper. Makes more room for consolation. God comes into our heart. He finds it full. He begins to break our comforts and to make it empty. Then there is more room for grace. The humbler a man lies, the more comfort he will always have, because he will be more fitted to receive it. See, I think Spurgeon perceives a truth here. There's purpose in the trials, purpose in the sufferings. They create room in our hearts to receive from the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, where Paul speaks of his affliction and persecution, the affliction and persecution of the apostles. He says, 2 Corinthians 4:16, so we do not lose heart. He says, we are pushed down, we are crushed, but we're not forsaken. We're not in despair. Persecuted, but not in despair. He says, so we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Paul says that the affliction we endure is actually working in us, preparing for us an eternal weight of glory. He says in Romans chapter 8:18, for I consider that the sufferings of this present world are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Paul, here in Romans 8, also uses the metaphor of labor pains. He calls them light, momentary, not worth comparing. Really? Really, Paul? Countless beatings? Scourgings? Being stoned and left for dead? Shipwreck? Abandonment? Betrayal? Lack of your basic needs? Really? Light? Momentary? Yes, light. Momentary affliction. That is working in us an eternal weight of glory. Not affliction that will be replaced by glory, but affliction that is accomplishing for us, that is digging deep my capacity for joy. In proper perspective, the affliction is seen as light, as momentary, as transient, temporary. The glory, the joy, on the other hand, is weighty beyond all comparison. The joy will overwhelm any sorrow and make it as if it were nothing at all. You might say, but you don't know what I've been through. You don't know my pain. You don't know what's been done to me. You're right, I don't. And I don't want to undermine, I don't want to invalidate anything you have experienced. But what I want you to see is that this is true for you, no matter what you have been through. The joy promised us, think of your pain, think of your suffering, the joy promised us is greater than that, more weighty, more substantial than that, more immense, more powerful than any suffering you have experienced. The wrongs done to you can be swallowed up in unquenchable joy. I've tried to show you from the scriptures today that this joy is an enjoyment, a deep, satisfying, a weighty delight that is not grounded in outward circumstances. A joy that is not only not affected by circumstances, but can even thrive in the midst of, even because of circumstances, adverse situations. A joy that is so weighty, it can swallow up all sorrow. What is this joy? How do we get it? Back to Luke chapter 6, our passage on rejoicing and leaping for joy, even in the midst of suffering, Jesus links this kind of joy with love. Luke chapter 6, verse 27, "But I say to you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. To the one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. From the one who takes your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you, and from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them." As you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. Every aspect you see of this fruit is linked with all the others. Rejoicing and leaping for joy while being persecuted is linked to love for enemies. Remember, love is willing, even joyful, self-giving for the good of the other. And you see, joy accompanies that kind of love. Start loving like that. Love the way you would like to be loved. Well, would you like to be loved even when you don't deserve it? Would you like to be loved even when you deserve the contrary? Would you like to be extended grace? Would you like to be extended forgiveness? Have you been extended those things by Jesus Christ? Love like that. Love your enemies like Jesus loved his enemies. And in the love, you will find joy. This kind of joy. Jesus loved the rich man. He wanted him to experience real, lasting joy. He wanted him to have a joy that moth and rust could not destroy, that thieves could not break in and steal. He wanted him to have joy in following Jesus. But this man went away sorrowful. Why? Because of unbelief. He did not believe that the treasure in heaven was greater, was more weighty than the treasures of this earth. You see, we're in a war. We have a fight on our hands. We talked about this some weeks ago. In love, Jesus calls us to make war on our fleshly desires. Do not settle for all those things that do not satisfy. Insist, fight for having the true joy that Jesus offers. We must fight for joy, and we must fight with joy. Joy is a weapon. It is a weapon that is deadly against our sin. It is one of the most powerful weapons I have found personally in my own battle with temptation and lust and sin. We fight for joy, and we fight with joy. We can overcome temptation only because we have something better. We have something better. Are you enticed by the dollar store trinket when you are already in possession of the real thing? Are you tempted by the cheap imitation when you already have the real deal? You are, I am, because our desires are deceitful. Ephesians 4 tells us our desires are deceitful. They lie to us. They try to trick us. They say, yeah, what you have, it's really not that great. You want this cheap plastic imitation of what you have. Throw that away. Give that to me. Here, I'll give you this. I'll trade you. You've got the real thing. He's trying to take you for an imitation. Our desires lie to us, tell us the plastic imitation is better than the genuine article. The rich fool went away sorrowful because he felt that the change in his pocket was more weighty than an eternity of following our Lord Jesus Christ. He bit the bait. You have the real thing offered, and no, I'd like the change in my pocket. Contrast him, the rich fool, to the man in Jesus' story who found treasure, Mark 13. He found treasure in a field and for joy sold all that he had and went and bought that field. Understand, he gave up everything. He liquidated everything. He got rid of everything that he had. And he was not mourning its loss, grieving its loss. Oh, I'm so sad. I really hate to part with all this great stuff. It says he had joy. It was out of joy that he sold everything, that he ditched everything, that he liquidated everything, because he found something of infinitely greater value. He said, this is nothing. What I have is junk. I can trade it in and get that? Well, that's a great trade. I'm not looking back. I'm going after it. There's joy. Joy in the real thing. He knew he had joy because he knew that what he was giving up was nothing compared to what he was gaining. This is the joy of the Christian. What is our treasure? What is the substance of our joy? What is it that overwhelms all our sorrows and outweighs all our treasures? Paul says in Philippians 3:7, but whatever gain I had, I counted it as loss for the sake of knowing Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them crap. I count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, that I may know him. The thing that is better than all the gifts that we could possibly enjoy is the giver himself. So let me ask you, do you treasure the gifts? Or do you treasure the giver? He gives good gifts. Salvation is a marvelous gift. Do you treasure it because I am saved? I don't have to go to hell. I get to walk on streets of gold. I get to see my loved ones who follow Jesus. I get to be with them. Do you treasure the gift because it's a great gift? Eternal life. I've been given eternal life. Jesus says, this is eternal life. That you may know him, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom he has sent. This
It's not, hey, cool, I get to live. It's, I get a relationship with the giver of the gift. I get to enjoy the presence of God. The thing that is better than all the gifts we could possibly enjoy is the giver himself, that I may know him. The surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, being found in him, abiding in him, fullness of joy in my relationship with him. Can we pray with the psalmist? And I'll close with this. Psalm 16. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad. My whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Father, teach us to treasure you more than all the things that you give us. Teach us to treasure you more than family, more than relationships, more than careers, more than possessions, more than good health, more than good circumstances. Help us to allow the adverse circumstances to dig deep the tank of joy in our hearts, that we could have greater capacity to enjoy you. Clear out the junk that is in our way from enjoying you. God, we are not satisfied. We will not settle for a joy that is contingent on our circumstances. We want Holy Spirit joy, joy that is impervious to circumstances, that actually thrives in persecution. We want joy in you that is eternal. God, put our souls out of taste for the things with which the tempter baits his hooks. Give us a hunger for more of you. Give us a desperate longing that cannot be satisfied by anything this world has to offer. Give us a longing for you and you alone. And meet us in our hurt, meet us in our pain, meet us in our need, and show us that you are enough. You are more than enough. You can fill us. By your Holy Spirit, for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ, we ask that you would work this in us, we pray.